Thank you all for gathering with us this morning. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors here at the Axis, and I'm really glad that you've given up some of your weekend to be with us. Go ahead and turn to the Gospel of St. Mark if you haven't done so. And for those who are new perhaps with us, or those who have yet to take us up on this offer, we have the Book of Mark journals back at the back table there at the bistro near the table or near the doors where you entered. They're free for you. It's the Gospel of Mark with journal pages for you to jot down questions or notes or takeaways or different ways of you interacting with the text. So feel free to take one of those and begin following along with us. This is our 50th week in this study in the Book of Mark as we are in the middle here of chapter 11. So some context, Jesus is on his way. He's making his way into Jerusalem. And as we looked at last week, he was worshiped, he was adored. In the coming weeks in our text here, we're going to see he's going to be betrayed by one of his most beloved friends, and he's going to be arrested, and he's going to be killed. But he's entering here into the holy city, greeted with this exuberant worship. And the people who are worshiping him, taking off their outer cloaks and coats and jackets and palm branches, they were lining a way for him to enter into the city, much like we roll out the red carpet for celebrities and whatnot these days. They were lining the streets into the city, the street into the city, so they could welcome him, honor him as their Messiah. But here's the thing, is they weren't thinking, let's worship and welcome the one who's taking away the sin of the world. They're thinking, let's worship and adore and welcome the one who's come to kick Rome out of Jerusalem. They weren't thinking eternal, they were thinking temporal. They were wanting to be freed not from the oppression of death and sin, but the oppression of Rome and its rule. So they had in mind some sort of political conquering king, not who the Messiah really was, and that is a suffering servant. Through all the amazing things that Jesus did leading up to this entry into the holy city, like the healings, the teachings, the miracles, it's got the entire region set on edge. Because what's happening is like all signs are pointing to him actually being the Messiah. As they hold the Old Testament in their hands and they look at Jesus, they're like, man, this is very, very, very similar. Well, they welcome him. And then later on that day, he goes and checks out the temple. Remember, this is how we concluded our time last week in the text was chapter 11, verse 11. You can find it there in your text. This is like a hinge verse. It said, he entered into Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything in the temple, as it was already late, probably one of the last fellows in the room, he goes back out to Bethany, probably to the home of Lazarus, the one he brought back from death, along with his disciples. And now we come to our passage for today. And as we work through this text together, I have a question for you to consider. Think on this as we kind of work our way through the text. If Jesus were to physically follow you around for 24 hours, what are some things that he would want to change about you? What if he were to be able to enter into your mind and heart and know not just the outward actions, but the inward thoughts, motives, and desires. In a 24-hour period, what are some things that he would insist on changing? Think about that as we work through our text. Look in chapter 11 of Mark, starting in verse 12. So they go back out to Bethany after being there late that night to look at the temple. And on the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry. It's a beautiful text that Mark gives us here, some insight. Of course, he was the God-man, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, fully God, fully human. As God, he was never hungry. As man, he was hungry multiple times a day. Then verse 13, and seeing in the distance, as they're making their way from Bethany into Jerusalem, and seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see if he could find anything on it, some fruit. And when he came to it, he found no fruit. He found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he said to this tree, this fig tree, may no one ever eat fruit from you again. And his disciples heard it. Now there's a lot going on here, and we're gonna take a break for Advent starting next Sunday. And then we've got a couple weeks of vision series at the new year. And so towards the end of January, we're gonna pick up what we just read. And if you look in your text down at verse 20, you'll notice that he picks up the explanation of what he just did and what he just said about the fig tree. But for our time today, we want to have what's pillowed and enveloped here in between the fig tree teachings. That's where I want us to focus. And then we're going to kind of pick back up verse 12 and then 20 in January. So you have to wait a few weeks, okay? All right, so let's look at verse 15. And they came to Jerusalem. So they know he's already entered into Jerusalem, but they're getting into the downtown city, the downtown area of Jerusalem. And he entered into the temple and he began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats. He overturned the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. Jesus was a grown man, right? He is a force to be reckoned with. He flexes right here and nobody questions him. And in fact, Jesus, he knew exactly who he was looking at when he did this. He knew exactly why he was looking at them when he was doing this. He knew exactly which tables he was turning over and who they belonged to and why he chose that table of that person. And by the way, we're never told that Jesus ever hit or harmed anyone physically through this. John, in like a parallel account of the same story, tells us, he gives us some clarity here around some things that we're unsure of. John chapter 2 and verse 15, and making a whip of cords. By the way, I believe that Jesus enters into the temple the night before. He looks around, he sees everything. Then he goes back to Bethany, and along the way, he gathers what he needs to make a whip. And he fashioned and makes a whip all night long. And he thinks through what he saw. He thinks about the hope of Israel. He thinks about what he's to do. He's thinking about the religious. He's considering the poor that's being exploited by the religious in the temple. And he begins to weave a whip, knowing exactly what is before him the next morning. And I believe that that whip that he made was laced with tears, which I believe in Luke's gospel tells us the same story, that he weeps over Jerusalem as he enters to do this. Making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my father's house, my father's house. Do not make my father's house a house of trade. And his disciples remembered that it was written of the Messiah, that zeal for your house will consume me. Again, they're connecting dots, is what Mark's telling us. The disciples are making these connections. Again, the night before, remember, he entered the temple, he looked around, and so this reaction was well thought out. Regardless of several details that we're unsure of with this event, one thing we can know for a fact is that everything Jesus ever did throughout his entire life was precise. It was calculated. It was measured. It was intentional. He was never at any point in his life haphazard or erratic, not with his words, not with his way, not with his tone, and not with his whip. So to bring this down a bit for us today, let me encourage you not to use this passage in a way that it's often used to justify your anger, your angry outburst, and your harmful treatment of other people. Tread very lightly. You're not Jesus. You don't have his accuracy, nor do you have his intelligence. So be careful. In fact, you receive his correction, his rod of correction. You receive his whip of rebuke. It's rarely, if ever, your responsibility to be the giver of correction and rebuke, especially in this way. And so tread lightly if and when you find yourself holding the whip of rebuke, and do so with a lot of humility and meekness, lest you also be tempted in the same way. And much like the log in your eye analogy that Jesus gives us, be sure to use the whip on yourself before you try recklessly using it on other people, and use it on yourself a lot more than you use it on others. This would be the way that we're to handle ourselves. Verse 17, and he was teaching them and saying to them, is it not written, my house, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. But you have made it, you fashioned it to be a den of robbers. You've made it to be a hideout for bandits and criminals. You see, his anger was that of justice and injustice. And remember that he was calculated. This isn't rage. And so Jesus, he does this so that they would hear his words. He didn't truly want to run them off, but to pull them near, to get their attention. In this moment, which is often taken out of context, Jesus is consumed with a righteous anger, a holy zeal. And again, many refer to this passage to justify their behavior of like roughhousing and even abusing other people. Like thinking or saying, well, after all, man, Jesus flipped over tables, so I understand, you know, you doing this. Well, I can see that, but this passage does not nor should not give our emotions a blank check to swing away. When we're angry, you and I, we often lose self-control. We say things that we don't truly mean and we regret them. We often do things that are cruel when we're out of control. Not so with Jesus. With Jesus, his anger was completely justified, and he did what he did for others to be taught, not to be harmed, not to be hated. He never did anything that he ever regretted. Imagine living a life where even in anger, you do nothing that's sinful, nothing that you regret. He overturns tables. He overturns chairs. He drives out livestock and other animals that were there for sacrifices and offerings. And then he begins to teach the merchants. He teaches the customers. He teaches the worshipers. And we're only given a very brief summary of his teaching, the content of his message in the temple after he cleansed it of its hypocritical and abusive activity. You see, the temple was to be used to relate to God vertically, to connect with God through prayer, through offering, through sacrifice. But the religious people, the Pharisees, the scribes, the rulers, the chief priests, they were using it to work for their own ends horizontally, pretending to help other people worship God, but they were actually exploiting the poor and the vulnerable, exploiting those who were seeking to give devotion to God. They were leveraging that for their personal gain. And Jesus calls it my house, my temple. He refers to it this way, quoting Isaiah 56 and Jeremiah 7. He's declaring the temple to be his house. And so in doing so, he's declaring himself to be the Lord of the temple, to be Yahweh himself, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And when Jesus, he calls these guys robbers, he calls these guys thieves. He knows what they're doing. He's referring to the robbing others of unnecessary, unwarranted temple tax, and the robbing of God of his glory and exploiting the purpose of his house, the temple. And so Jesus clears the temple, and the chief priests, the religious folk, the scribes and the Pharisees, they hated this. He called them out. He revealed what they're doing. They're not tricking him. He sees exactly what's going on, and they hate it. They hate him. And the Romans, man, they're ready. They're ready to jump at any opportunity to prove their brutality and their strong governing force. They're looking for any civil instability, just like this. So they're ready. But the common folk, the average people, they love what they're seeing, I believe. Jesus is shaking things up. Remember, this is Passover week. Already there's this feeling of, this is not normal. This is it. Something's different. I've never seen the religious, I've never seen their eyes look the way they looked when Jesus was in that temple. Did y'all see that? They were afraid. The bullies, the ones who are so mean to us as we come into this place, they ran in fear. The common folk love this. There's something going on. It's got everybody on edge. The vibe that you feel in Jerusalem on this day of Passover week, it's what you would expect it to be and think it to be as you think about the arrival of the Messiah. This is a different feel in Jerusalem. Look at verse 18. It kind of points to this. And the chief priests, the scribes, the experts of the law, they heard all this. They were desiring a way to destroy him. They were seeking a way to destroy Jesus, to destroy him, not to rebuke him. They were trying to find a way now, from this point on, to kill him because they were afraid of him. Because all the crowd were hanging on every one of his words. They were astonished at his teaching. So jealousy of the crowd's attention and fear of Jesus drive the religious ultimately to crucify Jesus Christ. Here it is. Jesus has to be stopped, destroyed. We have to stop it. At this point, the only thing keeping Jesus alive is his popularity. And then verse 19, when evening came, most likely out of protection for his disciples and himself, waiting for the right time, he went out of the city. You know, here in our text for today, the heart of Jesus is on full display. His heart is so open, it's vulnerable. The emotion of Jesus is seen very clearly here. He's driven by a jealousy and a passion for God that we should all be driven by. And he enters into the temple and he teaches a few things. Three of which, one, he's telling them, you've converted the temple into a stock market exchange room for you to get rich. You're ruining the temple in this way. And you've turned, second thing is, you've turned what is supposed to help free people of their burdens, temple, offerings, experiencing forgiveness. You've turned this into a place where you're loading burdens on people who are weak. And thirdly, you've made what is supposed to be a place of prayer and hearing from God, relating to him. You've made it into some sort of pyramid, get rich quick scheme that's only profiting your pockets and it's doing nothing for God's people. Essentially, you're taking the things of God to get things from the people of God in the name of God to make you comfortable. You're using the temple to be a tool for your purposes, to add to your comfort. You're not stewarding what God has given you. You're not stewarding the temple as an opportunity for others to draw near to him. You're leveraging the temple for your own pleasure. The purpose, the essence, the sweetness of the temple is being ruined by your greed, your self-righteousness, and your pride. And so what happens is Jesus graciously gets their attention. He rebukes them and he teaches them. And so they respond by wanting him destroyed. He graciously gets their attention. He even uses a whip to do so. Now, please know this. Regardless of what it takes, it's always grace when God gets your attention. Whatever it takes, it's always grace when God gets your attention. Always. It's like suffering for the life of a Christian. It's like God sending us an RSVP, wanting to hear back. Let's get some time. I want you to hear from me. Regardless of the rebuke, regardless of the intensity or sensitivity of the teaching that comes, it's always grace for Jesus to take time to address us, even if it's a whip. The indifference of Jesus should frighten us, but the discipline of God towards us, oh, that should comfort us. He's treating us as sons. He's caring for us as daughters. When life is hard, it's an opportunity to turn to God, not to run away from God. Here, Jesus, he calls out the religious for their money-making scheme, and now they want him destroyed. And it's a picture of how you and I so often are. So many of us, myself included, we want to hear from God. We want to know God. We want to feel near him. We want to follow him. We want to know his way so we can follow his way. But as soon as his way goes in a different direction than our way, than what we had expected, than our plan, when his way leads us in a direction away from our feelings, our thoughts, and our hopes, when it goes against what we feel is best, we reject it. And we want his voice and his way no longer part of who we are. And so we push back and we walk away because we can't think of this being good. So since it doesn't make sense to us, we push back. But we gotta be careful. We gotta be careful because the Bible tells us that there's a way that seems so right to us, but it's not. In fact, it's wrong. Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 12, there is a way We often talk about God's way and our way. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end is death. And this is, I love how Solomon gives us Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't trust yourself. Don't lean on your own understanding. Don't lean merely upon your feelings. In all your ways, you acknowledge him and he'll make straight your paths. Be not wise in your own eyes. You're often blind. Don't be wise in your own eyes. But you fear the Lord instead and you turn away from evil instead. It's going to be healing to your flesh, refreshment to your bones. Echoing what's been said in song and by Daniel and by Gordon, we must base our lives on the objective rock of Jesus Christ and the unshakable word of God. It's then that we lose control, but it's then that life makes sense. It's then that we find life. My dear friends, I'm asking you this morning to surrender your life to Jesus. And I know that you want to walk away from him. I know that some in this room are hurting so bad and they've got such deep questions. They've been so disappointed and you want to walk out on God. I know that you want things to be different for you. And trust me, I believe you when you say that your life is hard. There's no critic here. I believe you. But regardless of that, because of that, come to Jesus. Surrender to him in his way. It will be joy. It will be hope. You will discover life and, even in the midst of difficulty and suffering, contentment. Contentment. Things aren't the way I want them to be, but it's going to be okay. Contentment. Matthew 11, Jesus tells us, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, worn out and weary, discouraged and depressed, come to me. That's who he desires. If that's you, he desires to be near you. And he wants to give you rest. And that's not a bait and switch. That's not a come to me and I'm going to give you work. It's a come to me and I'm really going to give you rest. Take my yoke, my burden upon you. Now, I want you to learn from me. I'm gentle. I'm lowly in heart. The only time Jesus in scripture describes who he's like his nature, his personality, if you will. He describes himself not as mighty and strong, vengeful, gentle, and lowly in heart. Come to me and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So to my friends who are suffering, come to God and seek refuge. Remember, as Daniel was opening up, the very first scripture that you heard today from this platform, in you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Come to the Lord this morning, my suffering friends, and find refuge in his eternal promises. Find refuge in his truth. In the middle of the worst time in your life, go near to God and he will draw near to you. And regardless of how long it's been since you've prayed or read the Bible or had positive thoughts about God, call out to him. You don't have to earn your way to prayer. You don't have to earn your way to calling out to him for help. Regardless, because it's been so long, call out to him in prayer. Regardless if it's been so long, call out to him in prayer. And to my friends who've had a pretty decent go at it lately, life is kind of finally working its way out since 2020 for you. Go to God before there's a problem. For those who are experiencing a lot of grace right now, go to God before there's a catastrophe. Go to God simply because he's the best one to go to. Go to him because he's the greatest one to run towards, because he's gracious and kind and he loves you and he likes you. Friend, we do this by repenting early and often. We do this by walking in the light. We do this by confessing our sin, open, ongoing confession of our sins, and by doing all things necessary to stop hiding and justifying our sinfulness. Learn to go to God and stay with him and be near him. Invite Jesus to come into your life today as if you're the temple, which is the New Testament teaching. The Apostle Paul teaches us that the Spirit of God doesn't reside in stone and in buildings, but the new temple of God is the heart of his people. That's where his Spirit dwells. Christian, God is in you as if he were inhabiting the Holy of Holies in the inner core of the temple. You are that temple, Paul tells us. And so invite Jesus to come into your life as if you're the temple in the text, and ask him to remove whatever stone he wants to remove, and to move any table that he wants to move, to flip over anything that he sees that he doesn't like. And don't be afraid, because Jesus will never move anything to damage you, but to better you, to care for you. Remember, he's gentle, he's kind, he can be trusted, he's tender. And as he moves the furniture, if you will, in your heart's home, know that though that be uncomfortable, it's grace. And it is for your good. This is what you need. And as he moves things around and it frustrates you, that's not where you wanted that chair. You're really proud of that and he's moving it out all the way. Like, he's putting it on the curb, but you want it. Like, as he comes into your heart and your life and he begins to organize things, as you invite him in to do so, it's gonna make things better, but it's not always comfortable. And when you get upset, when things begin to get uncomfortable as he moves things around, because it's not according to your preferences, but according to his, because he's your Lord, you're not Lord, he is. So as he comes in, remember who he is. Remember who he is. As you feel uncomfortable as he moves things around and reorganizes and reprioritizes things in your life and heart according to his way, it's like setting a bone, remarkably uncomfortable, but for your good. Remember who he is. As that doctor lays hold of that bone to set, remember that doctor's good. He's there to help you. He studied, she studied really hard to be able to know how to help somebody just like you. Remember who God is. He sets the furniture around like setting bones that are out of place. Remember what it says in Exodus chapter 34, the Lord, I am the Lord your God. I'm a God merciful. I'm a God gracious. As he's moving stuff around and you're pitching a fit because it's not what you want, you're against what he's wanting to do, remember that he's gracious. Remember that he's slow to anger. Remember that he's abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands. Remember who he is. And humble yourself and ask him to have his way with you, to allow you the grace and faith to trust him in his way as you give him complete and total access to all of who you are. And ask yourself this question: what tables in my life does Jesus need to flip over? What tables in my life, in my heart, in my mind, in my activities, in my responses, in my way of thinking, what tables in my life does Jesus need to flip over? But I'm afraid to let him do it, because I know what it might mean. What is that? What are those tables in regards to your marriage? Where is it that you need to give him total access to do his thing in your gender questions? Where is it? Where is it in your life in regards to what your eyes see in secret that you need to give him access to? What tables are there in your heart that he needs to address in regards to your hate, your frustration, and your anger? There are tables in your heart built around your sexuality that you need to give him permission to address. Your purity, your holiness. There are aspects of your life that revolve around your hopes and your expectations and your dreams that you need to let him have access to and move those pieces of furniture anywhere he wants to in your heart. You must welcome him into your life to address the things that you feel and fear. You've got to give him access to the table of the private life that you're living. And be okay with the change that would come from that. And maybe even the difficulty in confessing that. You got to trust him with that. Just give it to him. There's things in your past. There's tables of your future that he needs to address. He needs to move around. He needs to have access to. There are things within your spirituality that you've got to give him, you've got to trust him with. For those who have children that are rebelling, they're wayward, they're drifting, You've got to give that table to the Lord to let him handle in his way, in his timing. You've got to trust him with that. You've got to release control of that. It's safer in his hands. Your holiness, your finances, the desire for a spouse. You've got to trust the Lord at that table. Desire for a child. That's a table that you've got to open up and let God have access to. Your addictions. The things that you don't think are addictions, that are addictions. You need to tell yourself the truth and open your heart and let God have that table and let him handle according to his liking. Your clumsiness, your sufferings, all these things and more. You've got to give God access to these things. Ask him to enter into the temple of your life and swing away and flip over whatever he has to. Whatever it is that's in conflict between your desires, your plan, your way, and the way that God says in his word must be, you've got to give him complete and total access to that. You've just got to lean on his understanding, his way, not yours. You've got to trust him with everything. With everything, and follow him in obedience, regardless if it makes sense to you. You follow him, you trust him, you obey him, regardless if it makes sense to you. The Christian life is that of faith, not reasoning, right? If it makes sense to you, it's probably not faith. Follow him, even if it doesn't feel right, but it says so in his word to do so. So you're gonna go against it, against your feelings, in order to follow what he says, and that's called faith, and that honors him. It's not foolishness. It's obedience. It's dependence. This is where your joy is found. This is where your contentment is found. This is where your happiness and satisfaction is found. You giving God access to everything, where you completely surrender. This is part of what he says and what he means and what he's getting at when he says, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself. You can't follow yourself and follow Jesus at the same time. You can't go your way and his way at the same time. You're assuming that they're the same. They're not. Abandon your way. Look here and follow him according to his way. Not culture, not your gut, not your logic. You test all those things with this, and you live according to this as if it were a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. This will guide you in the way that you should go. But that's so difficult. Give him complete and total control of anything and everything in your life. And you ask him for faith to trust him, to turn over the tables that you feel need to be there. I really like that one. Ask for faith, for him to give you faith, to let him take even that one, to remove anything, to replace anything, to reorganize anything in your life. This is what Christians do. In fact, happy Christians are those who ask for this, allow this, and pursue this. And they often hate it. There's not many people that I know, many Christians that I know, that if they're honest, they like this. There's not a single Christian that I know of that's experienced this rearranging of their heart's furniture where it was easy. But there's not a single one that I know that's done it that said they regretted it. Open your life to him. Ask him to do this in your life, believing it's best for you. Trust him to come into your heart's home and reorganize everything according to Jesus. This is sanctification. This is sanctification, where you invite God to be your heart's interior designer and move everything, redecorate anything. You open up and you say, have your way. Now, unhappy Christians aren't this way. They might ask for this sort of rearranging, but they don't follow through with it. And they keep certain rooms off limits, certain closets off limits to his rearranging and his attention. Or at best, they'll let him move things, but then as soon as he leaves, if you will, they go right back and they move everything back to the way it was before. They'll give him partial access, but they won't open all the way up to all of who he is. Sanctification often doesn't make sense. It goes against who we really are, we feel, but that doesn't mean that it's wrong. If we're not careful, Since many of the needed changes don't make sense to us, we'll refuse God's activity in our lives simply because it doesn't make sense to us, simply because it's requiring faith of us. And so we will not invite this into our lives. And this is a miserable way to live the Christian life. It's like wanting to give God complete control, but then trying your best to remain in control. It's asking God to bless your decision, but not to give you wisdom in your decision-making. Invite God into your decision-making. and bless the decision that he leads you to. Don't ask for a rubber stamp to bless what you've already thought through on your own. Proverbs calls that foolishness. That's the road to misery and death. It's not a way to life. And so I'm asking you to humbly and by faith ask God to come into your mind and your heart and ask him for faith and guidance and wisdom and ask him for mercy and the ability to live today for his glory and even take it a step further. Ask him to help make this pursuit of sanctification fun and a joy. Even though it might be difficult, ask him to make it exciting as he decorates things and changes things in your life. You know, Jesus, he entered the world, time and space. He entered into Jerusalem. He cleansed the temple. And soon after, he suffered. He died, was crucified, so that we could, by his Spirit, have our hearts cleansed and be forgiven, and that we could be welcomed into friendship and relationship with God, his Father. We're welcomed at the expense of Jesus being rejected. We're welcomed at the expense of Jesus being condemned. He took the judgment and the condemnation upon himself that we deserve. And it's this that we remember now during our time of communion and the Lord's table. During this time, I ask that you pray, that you think through what you've heard, and that you ponder and ask yourself this question: what tables in my life does Jesus need to rearrange? And then let him do it. In the coming days and weeks, let him do it. That is what you're looking for. It might not be what you like, but it will be what you're thankful for. And you'll discover contentment and peace. But ask him to come in and rearrange anything that needs to be rearranged. What I don't want you to do is just move on as if you haven't heard anything. What I don't want you to do is just go through the motions of communion. What I want you to do is think thoroughly through this, pray through these things, and live your life in his way, seeking his change in your life practically daily, removing yourself from the control center and asking him to take over and give you the grace and faith to follow him, the one who now is in control of all things, including your heart. Give it to him. We're gonna have servers on either side of the stage. We're gonna have self-serve stations in the back two corners. You're gonna take bread, which is symbolic of the life of Christ that he lived for you. And you're going to dip it into the juice or the wine, symbolic of the death of Christ, the blood that he shed for us. This is what we remember. This is what our hearts are focused upon. It's this, understanding what Christ has done for us. It's his work and activity that's released the Spirit to come to us, to save us, to forgive us, to cleanse us, the new temple, so that we can then be with God in the true and better new city forever in paradise. Set your minds and hearts on the finished work of Christ. Let's pray together. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we proclaim the mystery of the faith that Christ has lived, he's died, he's risen, he's ascended, and he will come again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now may the blessing of our triune God, Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of remembering, this time of pondering, this time of prayer, this time of worship and communion. And may you remain with us always, even through the end of the age. Amen. Christian, when you're ready, I invite you to come and take and worship the risen Lord Jesus. You can come when you're ready.